You know, a lot of people saying to Israel, oh, don't react, don't react, don't retaliate. I mean, that might be the statesmanlike thing to do. But I'm thinking if I was an Israeli and my country had just been attacked by more than 300 missiles from an enemy state, as in Iran, I might not want a complacent reaction on the part of my prime minister. I might want something aggressive. How do you think it's going to play out realistically? Will Netanyahu retaliate, Simon?
It does depend how much he's prepared to listen to those who have supported him and those who are urging him inside the country to, as you say, to retaliate. And that's a very moot question. I mean, it is interesting that the court of world opinion has rightly condemned Iran's attack, but has also then urged restraint. And it's everybody from all the G7 countries, the Secretary General of the United Nations, and indeed President Biden himself, who said very clearly, take the win. And I think the win is interesting. It's not just the tactical defeat of this operation, but look what to actually achieve that defeat. They managed to get Sunni Arab countries, albeit ones who have had their own problems with Iran, they managed to get Sunni Arab countries to cooperate in defeating this. You had Jordanians attacking those drone missiles. You had Saudi providing intelligence. You had Emirati providing intelligence. All of those countries who are no friends of Iran, but also find themselves in a very strained position now in relation to what's happening in Gaza, all those countries participated and cooperated together to defeat this Iranian aggression. Now, that was a strategic win. That's a strategic win. That's not just knocking a few missiles out of the sky. That's actually getting people together in a very difficult time with everything else that's going on in Gaza. Nonetheless, they came together and supported Israel. And the question I think for Netanyahu is, Do I give way to a perfectly legitimate and perfectly understandable desire for some kind of revenge, or do I actually take this not just the tactical defeat, but the strategic win? And I think that's why people are urging to restrain. You know, you've achieved something really extraordinary here. You brought all those countries together to support you against this particular attack. Hang on to that, build on that, and don't give way to the desire to carry out some kind of retaliatory revenge attack, because they will not support you.
Yeah, I'm glad you brought that up, actually, because that was my big take home from this weekend, how remarkable it was, in fact, to see the Arab world coming together with the West in order, frankly, to defend Israel. And there may be elements of legacy proxy wars between the Shias and the Sunnis involved in that. But I think also the Gulf states have just had enough of this. They want five-star hotels and resorts. They want world-leading airlines. They want to host sports competitions. They don't want to be dragged back into the mad theocratic wars of their troublesome neighbours, who, frankly, they don't like. But when it comes to Israel's response, do you think there still will be some sort of response, even if it isn't sort of frenetic and kinetic, something, again, a bit more targeted to weaken Iran while it's been found to be a pariah state? Because, frankly, the mood music I've heard coming out of the EU so far on this is not to do anything, not even to impose sanctions on Iran. And yet, you know, if they don't do something, one could argue that they've gotten away with it.
No, I think there's something in that. In a sense, what we might end up with is it like a return to what we've had prior to this attack, or actually this exchange of attacks, the Israeli attack on the Iranian consulate in Damascus, and then this response by the Iranians. There's been this sort of low-level war by proxy, war by discreet assassination ongoing now for a number of years, and obviously heightened slightly during this period after October the 7th and the attack by Hamas. And I think what we will see definitely is a kind of return to that. There's also conversations ongoing around whether or not the IRGC, who are the military arm of the Iranian state, are carrying out a lot of these operations, or at least doing the training or mentoring, educating, guiding, intelligence, whatever you want to describe their role in there, and whether they will be fully prescribed as a terrorist organization, which I notice we're still havering over at the moment. So I think a short answer to your question is, yes, we will see a return to that, but it may not be a kind of direct, very much, you know, all trumpets blaring retaliation, as some people in Israel are asking for.
Where do we stand, Simon, when the President of the United States, traditionally the all-powerful voice in the Middle East, is frankly being ignored. I mean, Netanyahu isn't listening to him all that much at the moment. And when he issued his instructions for Iran in terms of their retaliation that happened at the weekend, the president said, was asked, what would your advice to Iran be in terms of this attack? He said, don't. And was completely ignored. So both Iran and Israel don't seem to be paying much attention to the secretary, or rather the president of the United States. Does that not make the situation in the Middle East somewhat precarious when we have such a weak president that no one listens to him?
I think what it does indicate is the way in which, if I influence the United States and its power is no longer what it was. And I think that does make for a more complicated, more dangerous world. One which we, as our own country, need to adjust to. We can't assume that we have a Pax Americana that seems to have disappeared. It's been fraying at the edges for a number of years. I think really ever since the withdrawal from Afghanistan and the very messy situation being left behind in Iraq. The days when a U.S. president could just say "don't," both to a friendly country, in the case of Israel, and to an opponent country in Iran, and be listened to, I think are over. And so we are now in a more complicated, more dangerous world.
Iran's response was very much in order to save face after Israel, I think quite rightly, took out the general of their Quds force. Of course, I mean, not spoken about enough in Western media, the man frankly responsible for arming and training all of those terrorist proxy entities from Hezbollah to the Houthis to Hamas, who are creating all the instability in the region. But rather than save face, one could say that Iran has egg on their face. They look even more like a pariah nation. Do you think Iran expected all of their drones and their missiles to be intercepted before they could land? Or do you think that has been a massive failure?
I think it's a bit of a mixture. Iran signaled quite heavily what it was going to do. It talked to the Iraqis, it talked to the Emiratis, it talked to the Saudis, and explained to them what they were going to do in advance, probably in the very clear knowledge that information was going to be passed on to the Americans. And we saw it in the week before this attack. General Kurilla, who is the general in charge of US Central Command, moving around the Middle East, coordinating this air defense effort. So there's an element where this whole thing is, if I dare say, slightly stage managed. This was what you might call a demonstration in response to a direct attack on, and I know they were occupied, the people who were in there were al-Quds generals, but this was actually nonetheless sovereign Iranian territory. It's one of those conventions, a bit like the International Red Cross and Red Crescent conventions, that people at least give lip service to, that embassies, consulates and so forth are regarded as sovereign territory. And Israel decided, for its own reasons, to ignore that convention and to attack that consulate in Damascus. Some kind of response from Iran was almost certain to happen after that. What they also were clear, though, is they didn't want this to go on over much. They very quickly said, even before the attack was fully launched, that this concluded the matter as far as they were concerned. And at other stage in this whole period since October the 7th, we've seen Iran trying to pull back some of its proxies when they felt the Americans were going to intervene with them. And they began signalling to the Americans, and the Americans signalling to them about what the limits of what they were trying to do. So there is at least an attempt to try and control and constrain this. The danger we now put ourselves into with these series of attacks is actually that control and constraint, however limited it is, and it's very porous, but nonetheless those limits existed, will disappear. And I think that's what everyone's really worried about.